Hi, let's talk about the muscles of the pharynx. So the best way to conceptualize the muscles of the pharynx, or the muscular walls of the pharynx, is in two separate groups of muscles. There's one group, the pharyngeal constrictor muscles, which are largely semicircularly arranged as a set of nesting cups, where the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle nests within the middle, which nests within the inferior pharyngeal constrictor muscle. These muscles serially constrict so as to move materials distally through the lumen of the pharynx. The other group are the longitudinal muscles of the pharynx. These muscles serve to both widen and foreshorten the pharynx so as to help propel materials through it. Now, looking at this view, this is a posterior view of the posterior pharyngeal wall. We can see here's the foramen magnum of the skull, the occipital condyles. We've got one set of carotid sheath contents there, the other set of carotid sheath contents there. And we can see the pharyngeal constrictor muscles quite clearly. So I'm going to outline them now. So this is the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle. The superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle takes its origin from various portions of the skull, and each muscle meets its counterpart along a midline pharyngeal raphae. We also have a middle pharyngeal constrictor. Which we can see here. The middle pharyngeal constrictor takes its origin from the hyoid bone. There we can see the greater cornua of the hyoid, and each muscle meets its counterpart along a single midline raphae. And then we have an inferior pharyngeal constrictor muscle here. The inferior pharyngeal constrictor muscle takes its origins from the larynx, and there are two distinct parts to these muscles. But they each meet their counterpart along a midline raphae. The thyropharyngeal part takes its origin from the thyroid cartilage. So that would, we can see the superior horns of the thyroid cartilage here. So approximately here. I'm sorry about that. Bad selection. So let's see, that is going to extend up to here. Approximately this portion of it is the thyropharyngeal part. The inferior portion is the cricopharyngeal part. Now, before we continue on, let's erase a lot of this so I can point out some details to us. Coming down laterally here, we can see one of the three sets of longitudinal muscles. So this particular set of longitudinal muscles are the stylopharyngeus muscles. The stylopharyngeus muscles take their origin from the styloid processes of the temporal bone, and they have their distal attachment to the thyroid cartilage of the larynx. So one of the important things to note, an important relationship, is that of the bulk of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So that's glossopharyngeal nerve there. Rides down along the posterior aspect of the stylopharyngeus muscle. Now, the muscles of the pharynx are innervated by the pharyngeal plexus. This is a neuroplexus consisting of cranial nerve 9, which is glossopharyngeal, and cranial nerve 10, or branches from cranial nerve 9 and 10, which is the vagus nerve. Now, the bulk of glossopharyngeal is afferent, or sensory. The bulk of vagus is efferent, or motor. One of the great exceptions here is this stylopharyngeus muscle, because stylopharyngeus is efferently innervated by the glossopharyngeal nerve. So glossopharyngeal nerve is the afferent to the pharyngeal plexus, and it's the efferent to stylopharyngeus. All of the other pharyngeal constrictor and longitudinal muscles are served by the vagus nerve in an efferent capacity from the pharyngeal plexus. Another thing to note within the pharyngeal plexus is that it really doesn't afferently serve the nasopharynx. The nasopharynx is going to be afferently served by sensory branches of V2, or the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve. Now, these other two longitudinal muscles, the palatopharyngeus and salpingopharyngeus muscles, aren't going to be visible from this particular view. So I'd like to take a closer look of an internal view of the pharynx, and the mucosa hasn't been dissected away, but we can have a better idea of what we're dealing with here. So here is the epiglottis there, and we can see there's the thyroid cartilage kind of going down along the sides there. Here's the uvula, and then this is an extension from the uvula of the soft palate, and that's going to contain the palatopharyngeus muscle. So that palatopharyngeus muscle is going to come down like so and insert on the superior margin of the thyroid cartilage. We also have the salpingopharyngeus muscle. So salpingo means horn. There's an area called the salpinx, which is the distal end of the eustachian tube, or the pharyngotympanic tube. We really can't see it here, but it would be located deep to probably about that area. And that salpingopharyngeus comes down and it blends with palatopharyngeus muscle fibers on its way down. The other muscular contribution that we would have laterally, and this wall has been incised, would be the stylopharyngeus muscle coming down. So when these three muscles contract, they're going to elevate the larynx. And in the process of doing so, we also have a foreshortening and a widening of the pharynx. So again, all of these are controlled by the pharyngeal plexus, so largely going to be motor from the vagus. The exception is the stylopharyngeus, which is efferently innervated by the glossopharyngeal nerve. So there are two sets of pharyngeal muscles, the constrictors and the longitudinal muscles. The constrictors are under the control of the pharyngeal plexus. And there is one exception to that. If we kind of go back to this, sorry for that, that I should mention to you. And that is that the cricopharyngeal part of the inferior pharyngeal constrictor also has innervation from the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So this is an exception to the pharyngeal plexus innervating the totality of the pharyngeal constrictor muscles. But aside from the cricopharyngeal part of the inferior pharyngeal constrictor and the stylopharyngeus muscle, the remainder of the muscles of the pharynx are innervated by the pharyngeal plexus, branches of vagus. I guess we can consider that cricopharyngeal part is also a branch of vagus, albeit a recurrent laryngeal nerve. And the large exception here to efferent innervation would be the stylopharyngeus. Thank you very much for your time.